I request the chairperson of the session, Dr. Shabima ma'am, to take over. Please, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Zima. OCD in children is one of the challenging disorders from the point of view of the treating psychiatrist as well as the patient. In terms of diagnosis, as the presentation of symptoms is a lot different in the child as compared to the adult, and from the child perspective, it is difficult for the child to express himself or herself freely about the ego dishonesty and the intrusiveness involved, etc. Also, in terms of management, there is a limited number of medications available. Are FDA approved in children, and as Dr. Soumya already spoke about the difficulties in getting these children into therapies for OCD. So here we are, Dr. Arya. Here we have Dr. Arya Krishnan to take us through OCD in children and its management. Dr. Arya Krishnan is currently a child and adolescent psychiatry fellow in Massachusetts General Hospital, Boston. She has finished her MD psychiatry from PGI Institute, Chandigarh. She is a gold medalist, and she was a former senior resident at All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, and at the Institute of Behavior and Allied Sciences, IBAS, New Delhi. Later on, she was a research scholar at the Department of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry at the Zucker Hillside Hospital, and resident in the General Psychiatry Residency Training Program, Drexel University College of Medicine. She has received a lot of awards into her credit. She has received the 2019 Psychiatry Residency Award at Drexel University College of Medicine for excellence in cognitive behavior therapy. She has received the 2019 award for also excellence in her scholarly activities. She is a winner of the CBT award at the Colloquium of Scholars, Philadelphia. Her poster titled "A Systematic Review of the Use of Long-Acting Injectable Antipsychotics" won the second prize in the original research category in the same forum. She represented as 2019 finalist Drexel University at the APM Mind Games, which was one among the 125 teams competing from all over the world. A special honorable mention to the poster titled "Clonidine Abuse" in the Philadelphia meeting. She was nominated by the Drexel Psychiatry Residency Program for the annual Pride Fellowship. She has around 10 publications in peer-reviewed national and international journals, and several oral paper and poster presentations has been done by her in various national and international fora. She is a resident fellow member of the American Psychiatric Association and American Academy of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry. She is a life member of the Indian Psychiatric Society. I've personally known her for about 2 decades now. She's a very good friend, an empathetic listener, and most of all, a compassionate woman. It's been great knowing you and growing up in psychiatry with you, Dr. Arya. Over to you.
Very good evening to my virtual audience in India, and good morning to anyone who might be listening in from the US. Am I audible before I go ahead?
Yeah, you are audible.
Okay. Great. Thank you, Dr. Shabiba, for the introduction. It was very generous and very inclusive. As Shabiba had introduced, I'm Arya Krishnan Rajalakshmi. I am currently a clinical fellow in the Department of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry at the Mass General Hospital, which is a primary teaching affiliate of Howard Medical School in Boston. So my topic for today is obsessive compulsive disorder in children and adolescents. And we will be spending the next hour in an overview of this particular topic. But I thought it might be worthwhile for me to first give some context to why I chose to speak on this topic before I dive in. So bear with me. If I'm too long, then you, if I go on for a while, then you can wave frantically and I will stop. But my interest in this particular subject dates back to my first residency in PGI Chandigarh, when I was first introduced to this entity of OCD. We had a regular influx of patients with OCD in the outpatient settings, but it was with, and all of these patients had very rich and varied phenomenology. But it was in the inpatient setting wherein we got the opportunity to work closely and provide intensive treatments to these patients. And here it is that I came face to face with how severe and how impairing this illness can be. And I realized that the kind of dysfunction that it causes is quite comparable to severe psychotic illnesses like schizophrenia. But what was also rewarding was noting that there were effective treatments that were available. I can very vividly recall a case conference that I presented of a 30-something male who was so crippled by OCD. He had obsessive slowness. He had this need to go over, review, and revise all mundane events from the past hour every single time for him to move forward. And his life had kind of come to a standstill because of the nature of his symptoms. But I also recall, and it was very rewarding, that with some medication changes, he was able to show dramatic improvement. So I think this experience also influences my perception of how there is a lot of optimism and hope when it comes to treatments for OCD. But I think even since early on, other than this kind of clinical variety and complexity, the other thing that is very striking about OCD the consistency and relative clarity when it comes to what we know about its neurocircuitry, which is quite unlike a lot of other psychiatric disorders. There are also a lot of compelling animal models for OCD, and I'm not suggesting by any means that we know all that there is that needs to be known about what drives OCD, but I do feel like this is a disorder that's at a better kind of place relative to other disorders. And when we're moving towards an RDoC model and there is so much of push for biologically based diagnoses, I feel like OCD is definitely at a better position. So a lot of my initial experience in OCD was with adults. It's only since I moved to the US, and particularly at Mass General, that I've had the opportunity to work with children and teens with this disorder. And in this short journey, I've been able to observe and work with a variety of presentations. I've had teens who've had mild, moderate illnesses, who've shown remarkable improvements with behavioral treatments, with or without medicines. And then there've been some whose illnesses have been more complicated because of comorbidity. And these are ones in whom the treatment has been somewhat more challenging. And very recently, when I rounded on the inpatient unit, I had a chance to observe a 14-year-old male with such severe illness marked by extremely low insight, aggression, a lot of avoidance that really came in the way of treatment engagement. So in the short time, I've also been able to observe and realize that OCD exists in children. It can present in very many ways in different degrees of severity, and that there is effective treatment. Before I move forward, I also think that it's relevant for me to point out that I'm at a position of advantage because of proximity to the specialized MGH pediatric OCD and tic disorder clinic, wherein there's so much of clinical expertise and research activity, and I'm fortunate to work with, learn from, and train with some top-notch experts in the field, like Dr. Dan Geller, who've contributed to research in this field for over three decades. There's a lot of exciting research projects that are happening and that are in the pipeline in this center, all of which gets me very excited. And so I'm often guilty of kind of a very lengthy prologue that can eat into the talk in itself. So I'm going to check myself at this point. Long story short is, though I'm kind of earlier in my career journey, It's my sustained interest in the subject and my experience with working with different age groups in different settings that gets me kind of quite enthusiastic about giving this talk today. We can move right on. So in today's talk, we will be going over the epidemiology of pediatric OCD, the pathophysiology, understand the clinical features, assessment, and then move on to management and prognosis. Okay, so all of us know that an understanding of any illness is incomplete without understanding its epidemiology, which is what gives it context. So let's start right there. OCD in general, we know, is a common and very severe neuropsychiatric disorder. It can affect anywhere between 1 to 3% of the overall population, which shows that, you know, it's not an uncommon or an exotic disorder by any means. The lifetime prevalence has been shown to be 2.3%, which is kind of similar to disorders like schizophrenia, again, and maybe somewhat even more common. It is also one of the top 10 causes of global disability per the WHO, which is another reason why it merits a lot of attention and understanding. But this is as far as OCD goes overall, across all age ranges. It's been seen that OCD has two peaks. It was traditionally discussed that one peak is young adulthood, meaning the onset of 20 years, and the other peak being in early adolescence, a mean of around 14 years. Now, in all of these discussions, it was viewed as though the young adulthood onset is kind of the norm, and the earlier onset was regarded almost as an exception. However, recent studies, including this particular international multi-site report that I've cited, seems to suggest that this might be an underestimate of the early onset. Let's say this 2016 study has shown that almost about 50% of OCD onset in less than 18, which goes to show that a large proportion of OCD actually starts quite early on. What do we know about the prevalence of pediatric OCD? There have been a lot of studies that have looked at this over time, and the range that has been quoted goes between 0.25% to 4%. But it would be fair to understand that this is kind of pediatric OCD's prevalence is somewhat similar to that of OCD across the board. That is, the prevalence is somewhere between 1 to 3%. So the mean age of onset of pediatric OCD has been 10 years plus or minus 2 years, but the age of ascertainment falls at 13 something years, which points to there being somewhat of a 3-year lag between the onset of the illness and the time that's actually picked up. And one would assume the treatment starts. What do we know about the gender divide? So this is a disorder wherein there isn't a particular gender skew. However, with that being said, the disorder does have an earlier onset in males. It's been seen that of OCD in males, about 25% has an early onset, of an onset less than 10 years of age. In females, however, they catch up soon. The slope of onset is steepest in the adolescent years, when starting at this point, male and female OCD kind of stand side to side. There isn't a particular tilt. So discussions about epidemiology, again, would essentially have to also include comorbidity, because like our prior speaker said, and I'm assuming some others also alluded to, comorbidity is the absolute rule in pediatric OCD, and you'll be hearing this time and again. And this also applies to this particular disorder of OCD. So it's been seen that about 74% have at least one other comorbid diagnosis. And of this, anxiety disorders are probably extremely common. That is, if a child has OCD, then about 3 or 4 children who have OCD are likely to have some sort of anxiety disorder, be it a generalized anxiety, social anxiety, or separation anxiety. But anxiety in some form is what is most expected. Similarly, mood disorders, particularly depressive disorders, are seen almost in 1 in 2 children who have OCD. Comorbidity, as I've said here, is important to know because it influences treatment, it influences the response to treatment and remission, particularly with CBT, this has been studied. So some of the comorbid disorders that are important to know include, like I already said, anxiety disorders, depressive disorders, particularly in the
child age group,
it's important to also look at tic disorders, which are extremely prevalent. The importance also comes from, you know, earlier the discussions about pediatric OCD used to talk about a juvenile onset subtype, and this subtype was defined by its co-occurrence with tic disorders. And so these are extremely common co-occurrences. Also, tic disorders would also kind of call for a change in the medication approach, which is why it's important to know and screen for. ADHD is another frequent co-occurrence. We know how common it can be in children and treatment-seeking children, so it's important to also note. Disruptive behavior disorders, again, are very common in treatment-seeking children. They would also alter the treatment and the treatment response and participation, and hence important to know. Bipolar disorders would also alter treatment course. It is crucial to assess for OC spectrum conditions. I don't think I'm going to be going into a whole degree of detail about OC spectrum. Some of us might know that body-focused repetitive behaviors like hair pulling, skin picking, all of these would come under the purview of OC spectrum disorders, and they very commonly coexist. Hence, it's important to screen for. Now, autism spectrum and the overlap with OCD has also been an area that has received a lot of attention. That's because, for one, there can be a lot of phenomenological overlap, because we know kids with autism spectrum disorders are defined by having a lot of rigid repetitive behaviors, which can look like compulsive behavior from the outside. There can be ways that these can be differentiated, but what's also important is that there can also be a lot of comorbidity, that is, kids can have OCD and then they can also have autism spectrum disorders, and so that's important to know. Moving on to pathophysiology, which is an area that I had spoken about and boasted about with some excitement, even in my introduction. So what do we know about the pathophysiology? Let's start with what we know about the most, which is the neurocircuitry of OCD. Like I said earlier, so the neurocircuitry of OCD is probably an area wherein we've been most convinced by and have had most consistent associations over time. It's been very well studied, and the particular circuitry that we know of is the CSTC circuit, which stands for the corticostriatothalamocortical circuit. And it's been seen that this is a circuit that's been implicated and been responsible to drive a lot of the phenomenology of OCD. So this, again, I don't want to go into detail for the sake of time, but we know that pretty much the circuit involves certain direct pathways that connect the cortex and thalamus, and some indirect pathways that again connect between the cortex and thalamus, but via basal ganglia structures. Now, aberrations or abnormal activation of this particular circuit has been implicated in the pathogenesis of OCD, and this has been shown time and again. Kind of a continuation of the same. So based on what I already said, these are some structures that have repetitively been implicated in OCD. A lot of advanced neuroimaging, including fMRI, PET studies, have shown a hyperactivation of, you know, the prefrontal subcortical circuits on symptom provocation. The areas involved include the anterior cingulate, corpus callosum, basal ganglia structures. It's also been seen that this pattern of activation that is picked up on functional neuroimaging seems to be alleviated by treatment, which lends so much more credibility to these findings. Neuropsychological impairments in OCD, I wouldn't say that there's a huge body of research, but what's been done and looked at so far has shown impairments in executive functioning, attention, visuospatial functioning, memory and processing speed. We do know that these can be, the trouble with this can be very non-specific. A lot of childhood psychiatric disorders can show this pattern of impairments to different degrees. And so it's hard to use this as a marker for much, but at the same time, it is saying something. So discussions about pathophysiology in psychiatry, we know, always takes us to neurotransmitters. We know that these probably aren't the fundamental derangements that drive disorders. They are downstream changes likely. However, we know that a lot of our treatments are based on neurotransmitter disturbances. And so they're always studied. So what do we know about neurotransmitter systems in OCD, including pediatric OCD? Attention first went to the serotonergic systems, which you see in the top of the list. It's not hard to guess why that is the case. We know that SSRIs are the most popular medicines used in OCD, and so the serotonergic system got a lot of attention. Similarly, a lot of gene variations also kind of linked back to the serotonergic system. But over time, it's been seen that there are also other systems that are implicated based on the efficacy of antipsychotic augmentation. And again, some genetic studies, we know that probably the dopaminergic system is also at play in a certain capacity. Glutamatergic systems have received a lot of recent attention. And so again, this is far from a specific one-on-one kind of association, but is still discussed. Genetics of OCD. Now, family history is very relevant in pediatric OCD, as is in a lot of other psychiatric disorders. Why am I saying so? I'm saying so because it's been seen that OCD is around 10 times more prevalent in the relatives of a child with OCD than not. The heritability of pediatric OCD, as you can see, is much higher in the pediatric age group as compared to the adult age group. The heritability of pediatric OCD, as you can see, is anywhere between 45 to 65%. We know what this means is that about 45 to 65% of the vulnerability to OCD can be traced back to genetics, which is significant. Having said that, what do we know so far about the genetics of OCD, pediatric OCD? There has been a lot of work that's done in the area. Initial efforts largely focused on candidate gene approaches. As the name suggests, the goal or the intent was to try and identify one or a few genes that could explain the vulnerability to OCD. Again, the candidate gene approach looked at certain models. First, they tried to draw from neurotransmitter system-based findings, and there was a lot of attention to variations of polymorphisms in SLC6A4, which is the gene that codes for the serotonin transporter. However, over time, this attention dispersed to some other variations in genes that coded for serotonin receptors, glutamate transporters and receptors, and so forth. A variety of neurotransmitter systems have been looked at, as you can see. Candidate gene approaches also based themselves on an animal model. So one of the things that is striking about OCD, like I said earlier, is the existence of incredibly convincing, compelling animal models. we all can draw parallels to how there's a lot of repetitive grooming, burrowing, digging behaviors in animals that pose so much a resemblance to the compulsive behaviors in OCD that we see. Anyway, coming back to the genetics, candidate gene approach looked at animal model-based kind of studies, and they saw that there are a lot of gene variations that kind of link back to the glutamatergic system. However, one of the troubles with the candidate gene approach is that, you know, this mostly based itself on small samples and in treatment-seeking populations. And so the criticism is that these approaches might just be overestimating certain genetic findings, and that this might not be as important as it looks to be, which is why in the recent years, there's been a shift from candidate gene approach to genome-wide association studies. There have been at least four to date, which have shown very varying findings. However, overall, there might be a slight move towards the look for genes that kind of connect to the glutamatergic system, which makes the case for examining more closely treatments that work through the glutamatergic system. However, I feel like based on what we know about genes in OCD, we have probably come to understand that the search for a single gene or a few genes that could be responsible for OCD is likely to be futile. That's going to be an elusive search. What is very likely is a polygenic model of vulnerability, as in multiple genetic variants with small effects probably come together with environmental risk factors to contribute to vulnerability. We all know that this is probably also the kind of language that we're using in the understanding of other psychiatric disorders like schizophrenia. So pediatric OCD isn't too far behind. So this is probably one of the most exciting areas of research within pediatric OCD. That is, could this illness be influenced or driven by immune, inflammatory, infectious processes? And kind of at the heart of this discussion is this entity called PANDAS. Even before going ahead, we know that though the acronym says PANDAS, this just has nothing to do with panda bears chewing on bamboo shoots, totally unconnected. PANDAS is an acronym for pediatric autoimmune neuropsychiatric disorder associated with streptococcal infection. I know when I was in initial training, this used to be one of the favorite kind of questions that used to be asked. And so what do we know about PANDAS? Based on this criteria given by Swedo et al. In 1998, based on a description of 50 and odd pediatric cases, this is described as an acute onset, an episodic course, typically in the pre-pubertal kind of period, characterized by the presence of OCD and or movement disorders like tics. There's usually an association with neurological abnormalities like choriform movements. And what is essential to the diagnosis is establishing a temporal association between Streptococcus pyogenes infections and symptom onset or exacerbation. As you can see here, all of these criteria must be met to make a diagnosis of PANDAS. Now, as fascinating and beautiful as this sounds, the trouble here is that in the real world clinical setting, things aren't as straightforward. As in, we do see a lot of kids with acute presentations of OC-like symptoms and tics, but that doesn't necessarily translate to PANDAS. And this is an area wherein there's a lot of controversy brewing. And kind of talking about the controversy around PANDAS in itself could take easily an hour. I don't want to be derailed there, but I still would stop to say a few things. Why is there so much of confusion is, one of the things is, as you can see here, there needs to be a temporal association between infection and symptom onset. We know that kids have a lot of infections in general. They can have a lot of URIs. It is only rare that the cause for the URI is established. So we really don't know if there's a streptococcal infection that kind of predated symptom onset. even if testing was done, it is rarely the case that we actually are able to observe rising titers of ASO as is required. Cultures are rarely ever done. So again, we don't usually have solid biomarkers of strepto infection. Even if in the rare case that we had all of these markers, so it's often thought that the association between this infection and what we're seeing is spurious, as in the presentation might have nothing to do with this infection. They may just be very unrelated. And so the other thing is, we know that the validity of any diagnosis depends on being able to separate it from other disorders, which has also been very blurry and foggy with PANDAS. And so all in all, this is an area that's been looked kind of scorned at, looked at with a lot of criticism. A lot of academicians and clinicians have engaged in fervent debate over the years. Does this exist at all? Is this a valid diagnosis? Should we be talking about it, and so forth? But at the same time, this is a compelling presentation, and so it's hard to kind of just ignore it and go forth, which is why a lot of clinicians came together in 2010. They presented about 400 clinical cases with this kind of description, and they came up with this entity called PANS. The acronym stands for Pediatric Acute Neuropsychiatric Syndrome. As you can see here, I know it's kind of in minute text, but PANS depends on an abrupt, dramatic onset of OCD or severely restricted food intake. And this usually also requires a concomitant presence of two other things like emotional lability, anxiety, behavioral problems, sensory motor problems, and so forth. But what is important from this shift is that the PANS diagnosis does not require a group A beta hemolytic streptococcal infection to be established. The emphasis on PANS is on an acute onset, which is described as a dramatic, almost lightning-like onset of neurobehavioral problems in an otherwise fairly adjusted kid. So as you can see in this figure on the right, PANS is an umbrella term that is not wedded to a particular etiology, like you can see here. The etiology can include infectious causes like PANDAS, or there can be a lot of other non-infectious causes too. So long as the clinical picture is marked by an abrupt onset, then that would qualify for a PANS diagnosis. Now, even though people move to PANS from PANDAS, it's not that PANDAS has been replaced or eliminated. In the recent years, both PANDAS and PANS has continued to enjoy a lot of popularity among researchers as well as clinicians, who have continued to make efforts to better understand various aspects of the illness, like what are the clinical descriptors, what are the neuroimaging findings, what is the longitudinal course, etc. But of particular interest are treatment cancer considerations, like what do you do with these subjects who present with such phenomena. Treatment options that have been looked at are various, as I've listed here. Some initial attention went to the role of prophylactic antibiotics. Then it shifted to looking at corticosteroids. There were some small studies that looked at even NSAIDs. And then more recently, there's been attention to immunomodulatory therapies like IVIG and plasmapheresis. As you can see here, even tonsillectomy was looked at as one of the techniques. I don't think it really reached the light of the day, but that was still looked at, which is interesting. My own institute here at MGH has been a part of some of these studies. They've participated in some IVIG-based studies. And more recently, there is a study that's underway that looks at the role of NSAIDs. It's a randomized controlled trial that's looking at the role of NSAIDs in children with PANDAS, which I'm very curious to know more about. But while most of these discussions on inflammation and immunity and OCD keep getting back to PANS and PANDAS, it would be important to point out that interest has also been devoted to some further territory beyond just PANS and PANDAS. Like you can see here in this slide, there's this meta-analysis in 2019, which synthesized observations of studies that explored immunoinflammatory bases of OCD. this table shows how, you know, you have children with OCD that have been studied, you have children with PANDAS that have been studied, and some of these studies have looked at how pro-inflammatory cytokines are elevated in children with OCD. This kind of garners support for a hypothesis for OCD being set against a background of low-grade inflammation. This is a theory that suggests that neuroinflammation probably disrupts the crucial process of synaptic pruning by microglia in a very critical neurodevelopmental period, which in turn manifests in a wide range of neurobehavioral disturbances that include OCD. There are some other studies here, as you can see, that also have looked at autoimmune disturbances as a mechanism that have maintained OCD. You do see how some of these studies have picked up on anti-basal ganglia antibodies in children with OCD and those with PANDAS. So, like I said, this is a very intriguing area of research. But I know discussions on immunology and neurobiology of OCD can take a lot of time. We can move on at this point to clinical features. So I haven't devoted a slide to actually going over the diagnostic criteria of OCD. I didn't think it was something that we needed to do today. But based on what we know, OCD in children isn't very different from that in adults. There is a lot of overlap. There's a lot of continuity with adult presentation. However, most subjects have had multiple obsessions and compulsions that have changed over time in their content as well as severity. Another thing about pediatric OCD is that though there's a lot of overlap in phenomenology with adult OCD, some of the content is reliant on developmental themes in children. And a lot of these children do have minimal insight into the morbidity of their symptoms. Talking about the distinctiveness of childhood OCD, it's important to point out that in children, a lot of the times, compulsions can be seen very clearly and prominently without clear obsessions, particularly in younger children. This isn't hard to imagine because we know that obsessions are essentially mental phenomena. And so for a child to have to identify and articulate complex mental phenomena would be challenging. And so what usually comes to our attention are the compulsive behavior and not obsessions. And a lot of the times, even these compulsions aren't typical compulsions like washing or rearranging. Sometimes they can be somewhat atypical, like they can present with rapid breathing or blinking, which might also just represent OCD symptoms. But when obsessions do occur, some of the most common obsessions are fear of catastrophic events, contamination, sexual somatic themes, or guilt. Most common compulsions are washing, checking, ordering, or repeating, which is rather like adult OCD. An area within the clinical presentation of pediatric OCD that has received a lot of attention in recent times is this description of sensory phenomena that accompany the presentation. Now, we know that in disorders like autism spectrum disorder, for instance, we talk a lot about sensory hyperresponsivity. Now, this has also been looked at in other pediatric disorders, including OCD, wherein physical and mental sensory phenomena seem to usually accompany the illness. Physical sensory phenomena could refer to, you know, localized tactile or musculoskeletal sensations. Mental sensory phenomena could refer to just right perceptions. And it's been seen that in treatment-seeking kids with OCD, sensory over-responsiveness, or particularly tactile hypersensitivity, is seen in up to 30% of this sample. In fact, in one of the patients that I'm working with who has OCD, she's a 14, 15-year-old, she has a lot of tactile hypersensitivity in the sense she's very particular about her skin being very dry all the time and gets extremely upset if she experiences any bit of a sweat. And so she spends a lot of time in drying, patting her skin dry, which kind of speaks to how some of these sensory phenomena can actually drive compulsions, much like obsessions do. just right perceptions, as we know, refer to this kind of fixation on having things just a particular way, and they can get very irked if things aren't this case. It's been seen that up to 50% of kids with mixed OCD can have these kind of perceptions. And it's been seen that these sensory phenomena could have a lot to do with influencing the severity of the illness and impairment. And it also seems to indicate a poorer treatment response. Moving on to assessment, how do you go about assessing for OCD? In a kid who comes to the psychiatric clinic, it's very important to screen for OCD because children don't readily volunteer symptoms of OCD. And because comorbidity is a rule, even with children who are seeking help for other more obvious presentations, it would be worthwhile to screen for OCD symptoms. So how do you go about screening? Some of the DSM-5 probe questions are helpful. Questions like, do you have repeated thoughts, urges, impulses that upset you, make you anxious, that you cannot suppress, would be one probe question. If it's a younger kid, then do you have worries that won't go away could be a useful question. Examples are always useful with kids. You could give them examples like, do you worry about not being clean, that something bad will happen? You have similar probe questions for compulsions that I've listed here that could also be helpful. But like I said, it's important to bear in mind all the time that with children, you might even have to infer obsessions. They might not acknowledge it, even if you ask them specific questions. Sometimes you only have to base this on parental report on CBCL. That might give a clue to the need for further assessment. The standard scale is the CY box, the children's version of the Yale Brown Obsessive Compulsive Scale. It's a 10-item anchored scale. It mainly looks at five dimensions. It breaks down severity to mild, moderate, severe. It comes with this very useful checklist of over 60 symptoms that can be a guide for children with this kind of illness. Other important parts of assessment would be screening for comorbidity. We already said comorbidity is the rule. It would be crucial to screen for medical illnesses, particularly with the whole discussion of PANDAS. Looking for strep infections would be relevant. Family history lends a lot of support to the diagnosis. Family accommodation is something that I'd like to spend a minute or two on because this is a subject that has received a lot of attention and emphasis. Now, children we know are embedded in family context. And so is their behavior. This would also hold true for illness presentations. Family accommodation in the OCD context refers to behaviors by parents with the intent of helping children and diminishing their anxiety, but instead serves to reinforce symptoms. Examples would be in a kid who seeks reassurance as a part of their phenomenology. If parents go ahead and kind of reassure them in the service of suppressing their anxiety, then this could in the long term maintain illness. And this is what is referred to as family accommodation. Now, this is something that needs to be examined, looked for, and addressed in the course of treatment. So this is very important in assessment. It's also important to look at how are they doing academically? Is there a lot of impairment to go forward? So treatment broadly can be understood in terms of therapy and medication as for any psychiatric disorder. By therapy, the mainstay is CBT here, and the main medications that have been looked at are SSRI medications. The choice between these two would depend on a bunch of factors, like say, what is the severity of the illness, what are the kind of comorbidities, what does the patient or the family prefer, what is available, and what's the age of the child. These would be some factors that would guide our choice between these broad treatment areas. Starting with CBT, now OCD stands out as a common psychiatric disorder wherein the first line treatment status goes emphatically to CBT. This demonstrated superiority has kind of withstood the test of time. Over the past decade, you've had studies of improved methodological rigor that have established benefits from CBT. Here you can see this meta-analysis published just this year, which includes 9 studies that have compared CBT to no intervention and have firmly established its benefits. So any talk about treatments in pediatric OCD would not be complete without talking about this landmark study, which goes by the acronym of POTS, Pediatric OCD Treatment Study, which is conducted in 2004. This was a multi-site study that took place in three academic centers in the US. It looked at four arms of treatment: medication, CBT, combination, and placebo, and it looked at Y-box scores and remissions. Now, this study showed that even though in terms of absolute numbers, a combination treatment seems to be the best, actually, if you look at statistical differences, CBT in itself seems to be just as good as a combination of CBT and medication, which is a very important vital finding. Medication kind of follows behind and then placebo. What is this main CBT treatment for OCD like? So this is not a very non-specific form of treatment. In fact, it's a very specific, well-studied and perfected form of treatment called ERP, or exposure and response prevention. This is based on understanding the behavioral model of OCD, which pretty much says, you know, obsession leads to anxiety. In order to kind of relieve the anxiety, a compulsion is performed. But then this is only short-term relief, and within some time, the obsession resurfaces, leading to a cycle, right? So ERP, what ERP does is you deliberately kind of set up an exposure to the obsession, and when there is the anxiety, you educate patients to not yield to the compulsion.
Yes.
They are encouraged to just sit with the anxiety and do nothing, in the hope that in some time the anxiety will come down inevitably. And so we know that repeated exposures to anxiety can lead to a diminution of the anxiety response, which is based on this principle of habituation. Anyway, ERP in the pediatric setting is no different. Exposures are conducted in a very graded and systematic manner. Usually it takes around at least 3 months or 12 sessions. The conduct of pediatric ERP, psychoeducation would be useful to use developmentally explanations, like using metaphors to externalize OCD, say call it by names, call the OCD by a name like OC fly, kind of gives it a tangible form instead of it being an abstract version. Similarly, having a lot of in-session exposures, modeling by the therapist, using rewards, these are all very useful inclusions for using ERP in the pediatric world. It's also very important to include the family in treatment, because family accommodations, like we said, can come in the way of treatment progress, which kind of takes us straight to certain variations in CBT, which can be, there can be a family-based CBT, there can be a group-based CBT, internet-based CBT is something that's very relevant in these times. As we know, ICBT models they intend to bridge the gap of accessibility and availability barriers. It's also been looked at in OCD and pediatric OCD. There's been one such ICBT model called BIP-OCD that's been studied. And there was a recent study that came out that I've included here, which attested to the benefit and effectiveness of internet CBT in children. Now, like I said, this is something that's particularly pertinent to the current times, wherein we're having to shift largely to virtual treatment and therapy. So it's heartening to know that internet CBT has also been helpful in the pediatric age group. So given the paramount importance of CBT in OCD treatment, studies have also paid specific attention to what are the factors that seem to be a harbinger of response and what aren't. Based on the POT study, we know that lower severity, lower impairment, fewer comorbidity, lower family accommodation, and greater insight seem to predict better responses to treatment. This has also been replicated in a lot of other studies. We know that CBT is the mainstay, but then there are some situations that may also warrant medication treatment. Which could be patient reasons, they could be family reasons, they could be therapist reasons. Like if it's a severe illness, if there's a high degree of impairment, if there are comorbidities that come in the way of engagement in ERP, then we might have to look at medications. If that's what the family prefers, then that's another reason to consider medication. And then if we have the availability of skilled therapists, then if we don't have, I'm sorry, the availability of skilled therapists, then we might have to resort to medications as a first line. So amongst what we know about medications, serotoninergic medications, SRIs, are the medication of choice. But first line status does go to SSRIs, just because of tolerability profiles. There's also some discussion about augmenting agents, which could be antipsychotics and others, which I'll come to. SSRIs are the first line medication. They're used for moderate to severe OCD. They can be particularly useful when there's comorbid depression, and there are a lot of RCTs that have demonstrated the benefit of SSRIs. One such meta-analysis of 9 RCTs here has compared SSRIs and placebo and has clearly favored SSRIs as better treatment than no treatment. This is other recent meta-analysis that similarly shows that SSRIs have a moderate effect size. It's tried to look at whether there is a superiority of one particular SSRI, but that doesn't seem to be the case. There's a fairly comparable profile of benefit across the board. The FDA in the US has approved sertraline, fluoxetine, and fluvoxamine for pediatric OCD so far. A comparison of medication and CBT, however, there only have been a few studies that have looked at this, and they seem to have shown that CBT actually does better than medicines in pediatric OCD. What is the approach to medication treatment? It is start low, go slow. Based on adult OCD, there also seems to be some inclusion of wait longer, maybe use higher doses of SSRIs. But when I say that, it's also important to point out that most of this is based on adult OCD research. We don't as yet have conclusive studies in the pediatric age group that seem to support wait longer or go higher in terms of doses. But just borrowing from the adult OCD treatment world, we still rely on 10 to 12 weeks of treatment. And this is the dose range that I've shown here. A lot of times OCD treatment is very fruitful, but there are some times that we run into treatment resistance. What is treatment refractory OCD? It's defined as a failure to respond to an adequate course of CBT in at least 2 SRA medications. Response is defined as at least a 25 to 35% reductions in scores. Adequate CBT calls for at least 8 to 10 weekly sessions, and an adequate SSRI trial would be at least 10 to 12 weeks at the maximum tolerable dose. Now, what do we do if we run into treatment resistance? The algorithm is pretty much what I've shown here. You first start with, do we have the right diagnosis? Ruminations of depression, delusional beliefs of psychosis, repetitive behaviors of autism spectrum can all be misdiagnosed as OCD. So we need to kind of recheck that again. If we know we have the right diagnosis, we want to make sure we have the right treatments and the right ingredients and right doses. If medications have been tolerated so far, then there might be a role for maximizing dose and wait longer if possible. And if all of that is in place, we might also want to look at moderating factors. Are there comorbidities that come in the way of treatment? Is there a lot of family accommodation? Having done all of that, and if we feel like we've checked off all of that, we come to the place of augmentation. Now, in the world of augmentation in treatment of pediatric OCD, it's crucial to point out that there is a lack of empiric evidence supporting it. Much of the options discussed are based off adult treatment research. If not already tried, clomipramine is something that I've mentioned in the beginning, because this has been seen to be very effective, but the need for cardiac monitoring is what kind of sets it back in terms of popularity. Antipsychotic augmentation has been looked at a lot in the treatment of adult OCD. In the child world, this hasn't been again systematically studied, but this is a reasonable option and may actually be needed in children with OCD who have tics. Glutamatergic agents have received a lot of support in the recent times, because it's been seen that there's a lot of role for glutamatergic system abnormalities in OCD. There was an RCT on riluzole which showed that it was no more effective than placebo. NAC augmentation has been shown to be very effective in the one RCT that it was looked at. D-cycloserine augmentation of CBT wasn't particularly useful. There are some other agents that are in the pipeline that are being looked at. Treatment of comorbid illness, it becomes very important. I'm kind of repeatedly hammering this fact just because of the relevance of comorbidity in pediatric OCT settings. So what are the aspects that we need to know here? If there is a tic disorder that's accompanying OCD, then the usual SSRI treatment may not be just as effective. There's a lot of role to adding antipsychotic medications and using alpha agonists. If bipolar disorder accompanies OCD, then it's important to prioritize mood stabilization because we know that SSRIs can be a slippery slope in the treatment of children with bipolar illnesses. And so giving important to mood first is helpful. If there is OCD, then it's important to prioritize OCD treatment instead of using stimulants aggressively. If there is autism spectrum presentations that accompany OCD, then there is a role to use SSRIs just as otherwise. Disruptive behavior disorders require a lot of behavioral focus and parent management treatments before we start treating the OCD. The last part of my talk is a quick look at what do we know about the long-term course and prognosis. Now, initially, there was a lot of nihilism when looking at pediatric OCD. It used to be thought that this is a chronic illness with a grim prognosis. However, over the last one or two decades, we've had a lot of systematic research that seems to suggest otherwise. A very recent study is the Nod Lot.
I'm sorry, Dr. Are you
okay? Yeah, so I was talking about the Nod Lot study, which is a hallmark study in the course of pediatric OCD. This included three Nordic countries, and it included a pool of 269 children who were followed for 3 years. They first received CBT and then they were randomized to sertraline or CBT if they were non-responders. A very heartening finding of this follow-up is up to 73% of this initial pool seemed to remit later, and I'm sorry, this is a typo, 90% showed response. And so this is a very optimistic outlook on the course of pediatric OCD. Besides the Nod Lots, there have been a lot of other studies too over the last two decades. Me and my husband, also a psychiatrist, your next speaker, are now working on a meta-analysis of 11 studies that have looked at the long-term course of OCD. And again, we've seen that up to 62% of these children with OCD seem to remit, as defined by a Y-box of less than 10 over a mean period of 3 year follow-up. Again, this is very hopeful for children with this diagnosis. Having said all that we've said, we've come to the last part. Where do we think the future is headed in the world of pediatric OCD? Now, there's a lot of active interest and ongoing efforts on immune mechanisms and trying to understand that better. And so one can expect that there'll be a lot of fresh window into pathophysiology of OCD. Like I said, our MGH center in itself has been involved in a lot of such studies of pandas and immune mechanisms. One can expect continued foray into unraveling the genetics of OCD. Even though it hasn't yielded much so far, I'm sure that we'd continue to try to decode the genetics of OCD. One can expect that there'd be a lot of advanced neuroimaging studies to further understand what drives OCD. Informed by continued moderator research, the hope is also to move towards a personalized care approach. We will hope that 10, 15 years down the lane, we'd be able to go approach treatment as, you know, if there's a child of this age, this gender, this particular symptom severity, these comorbidities, this family background would respond to what type of treatment. So we'd like to kind of be as specific when approaching treatment. We also hope that there'd be so much more advancement in the pharmacogenomics of OCD. We hope that there'd be advances with treatment-based research. We expect that there can be more studies on head-to-head trials of individual SSRIs, on augmentation studies, and neurostimulation is something that I haven't spoken much about, but within the limits of safety, exploring neurostimulation techniques, even in the pediatric age group, is something that we might hope for. At MGH here, I know there is a talk, and we're about to get started on a study for TDCS in the pediatric OCD age group. And so they, one expects action. But that's pretty much what I have to say. And I'm also at the end of my time. Thank you so much for your patient listening. And if there are quick questions, I'm happy to answer.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Arya, for the lucid presentation. And things made simple in terms of the neurocircuitry, genetic and immune basis, and about PANS. And when it comes to clinical features, more of developmental need obsessions, ritualistic compulsions, and about the sensory phenomena, and of course about the role of family accommodation and the need for avoiding reassurance. And when it comes to treatment, about the ERP and the recent treatment-based CBT. So thanks a lot. We have a few questions for you. Arya, you can stop sharing your screen.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah, so there are many questions which you have already elaborately covered, like what are the antipsychotics that can be used to augment SSRIs, and about how to use the second SSRI when it comes to non-response to one SSRI with CBT. So, yeah. Any? Do you have any specific events or life trigger which exacerbates symptoms in OCD related to generalized anxiety? That is one question.
Yeah, I mean, of course, we don't have any. This is again something that's very similar and might also apply to other, not just pediatric, but other psychiatric disorders that we as yet don't know very specific type of events that could act as triggers. But it's true that our current understanding is such that we think a combination of genetic vulnerability superimposed with certain environmental stresses might tip the balance towards illness presentation. The specific answer would be no. I don't think we have a specificity to the nature of environmental triggers.
Okay. So there is one question from Dr. Niranjan Raghavan. Are patients with OCD more prone to addiction, not necessarily substance abuse?
Yeah. So again, there is comorbidity of all sorts is pretty much the answer for most pediatric psychiatric disorders. Substance use could well be a comorbidity. It doesn't stand out popularly as one of the top kind of comorbidities that are associated with OCD. One could always argue and understand that in an effort to self-medicate the kind of anxiety that these kids experience, they might turn towards substance use. So pretty much it could be a comorbidity, but it's not amongst the top few that one might actively scout for. However, it's important to do that screening just the same. It's also, that's pretty much also why it's important to treat, to do justice to treatment of OCD so that they don't lapse into substance use.
So we still have quite a number of questions, but due to want of time, I think we can take this offline, maybe via email or something. So thank you, Dr. Arya. Thanks a lot for your excellent presentation. And I hand over the session to Dr. Neha to proceed on to the next session. Thank you, Dr. Arya.